Amistad and Harper Audio present The Women Could Fly, a novel by Megan Giddings, performed by Angel Pean. One. On the day we all agreed that, yes, sure, okay, it's time, my mother was dead, I went to the storage unit where my dad kept all her stuff. I told myself if I wanted, I could burn it, take all the boxes and clothes and loved things out into the parking lot, kerosene, matches, patience, ash. Instead, I decided I would sort through it, choose a few things to save, clean the rest out and save my dad some time and money. I am a practical person. The unit smelled like black and mild jazzes, but I wasn't sure why. There were faint whiffs of her when I opened different boxes. Cedar, mint, rosemary. I want to be precise because every time I'm precise about her, she returns for a half second. Her hands on the fork and spoon in a way where I can see the dirt beneath her fingernails. Saturday mornings that she spent spread out on the sofa, legs crossed and eyes on the ceiling, a forgotten book on her stomach. My mother's hand on my forearm, her skin shining brown, and telling me I need to get lotion. She will not have her child walking around ashy. Her fingers pushing my hair away from my eyebrows and saying, just because your forehead is big, doesn't mean it isn't beautiful. Look, there you are. I said it aloud, again. Yes, sure, she is, probably, no, definitely dead. Say it again, like you believe it. My mother is dead. My voice was flat, yet hesitant. A box marked hair care, pomade, flat iron. A wig I had never seen her wear. Synthetic smell. Her books and research. My mother's biggest passion was researching our lineage. My great-great-great-great-great-grand-aunt was burned for witchcraft. Birds that stilled. Eyes that grew bright. Their beaks and feathers following her as she spoke. A refusal to take a husband. The accounts about her disagreed. The story my mother preferred. Our ancestor was just an ordinary woman. An ordinary woman in the wrong place, who upset the wrong man, and he used the laws of the day to teach her and all the other women in her village a lesson. Not a fun story, but an honest one. The story my father, my grandmother, my aunt, everyone else in my life prefers to tell. My ancestor was a witch. Her burning took place on a beach. The heat from the fire so hot, it turned sand into glass. My grandma has a bracelet made from the beads she swears came from that day that has been passed on from eldest daughter to eldest daughter. Our ancestress, when she couldn't handle the fire any longer, flew off the pillar and plunged her scorched feet into the sea. The smoke and steam sifted and became a week-long fog. It crashed ships, blanketed the town, made the people who had tried to burn her afraid to leave their homes. My grandmother's records say this ancestor went on to the United States. Her older sister's records say this happened on Oak Island in South Carolina. My other great aunt says no, this was New York. In school, like everyone else, like you, I was raised to believe that witches are still alive and living among us today. Although most have died in the great eradications. My family was divided. My mother believed witches were a hoax still perpetuated today to keep women afraid and oppressed. My worst cousins, the ones who are loudest on the internet, believe that witchcraft is maybe an illness, like if you're in the wrong room at the wrong time. Although for some it devolves into if you voted for the wrong person, you are a witch. If you vaccinate your children, you are a witch and are risking turning them into witches, and so on. And my uncles on my dad's side say shut up about witches and get back in the kitchen. Dinner should be served every day at 5:30 sharp. My mother pointed to the laws, how women are encouraged to be married by 30, how unmarried women starting at 28 have to do quarterly check-ins with the Bureau of Witchcraft to be tested. And what did being a witch have to do with being married? Didn't that seem suspicious? And what about how magic makes it tied to gender expression? How science can't even prove any links? Doesn't that seem a little too perfect? It seemed like that made it even easier to oppress two groups of people. Women, and anyone who did not conform to cisgender standards. She believed that most of what people believed was magic was actually just a way to wash out the accomplishments of women, make their hard work small. All her books, medicine, gender, herbalism, art, protest, sitting in those wilting cardboard boxes, waiting for her hands to pick them up again, to flip the pages. Once one of my dad's brothers asked him if he was uncomfortable with the way Tiana thought about things. Wasn't he afraid she would be accused of witchcraft? And worse, what did he think my mom's nonsense was doing to my brain? I love Joe's brain, my dad would say, and often that would be enough to change the subject. I picked one of the books up, one with a blue cover, flipped the pages, and did what I used to do when I was a teenager. Pretended for just a moment that my hands were her hands. At home, my mom would look at my schoolwork and roll her eyes. The burnings that happened were a very bad thing. You should never accuse a woman of witchcraft unless you have a very good reason to. Like she was actually hurting your family. And most witches don't even hurt people now. They are performers and artists. They stay away for all our safety. She never hung any of my A-pluses on the fridge, the way other moms did. Once I heard her whisper to my father, "I'm not celebrating lies." I put the book down. It was a donate, not a keep. In my mother's research box, my dad had thrown in some papers of mine from high school, a paper that had gotten a D- on where I had argued. Now I can see that I was simply echoing her, trying to keep her close. That everything we knew about magic was a lie. On the back page, a longer note about how my teacher understood I was upset about my family situation. That it was normal to be angry and act out. But I had to write about actual recorded, two underlines underneath the word recorded, history to do well in her class. Below that, another essay I had written my freshman year, still grieving her, about a strange experience I'd had when I was 8 years old. It was one of the rare times when my dad wasn't around. He was up north with his brothers. They were hunting. He was sitting in the blinds next to them, refusing to shoot. My mom was on the phone. I was half in reality, half in my made-up world. Marmillion. Everything there was made of potato chips and pretzels and popcorn and salt. Upstairs, in the attic, I heard what sounded like a horse's clip-clop. I wasn't scared. I was thinking of a Pegasus made entirely of mall pretzels with a horn made out of caramel corn. I would fly on it, then eat its horn. My mom was making a sound, and I couldn't tell if she was laughing or crying. I turned on the light to the attic, saying to myself under my breath, standing among the stacked cardboard boxes, the rolled up area rug, was a deer. Its fur was bright white, its eyes shiny black. It was large, with a crown of shining antlers on its head. I took a step back. It took a step forward. My mouth was open, and it was so dry that my tongue felt like it was a piece of cut wood. The deer huffed at me. I could tell somehow that it was deeply annoyed. "I'm sorry," I said, and walked backward downstairs, My mother was still on the phone. I tugged on her sweater. It was ugly. Red, lime, black, stone gray, and scratchy. I don't know why she ever wore it. She turned to me, and tears were running down her cheeks. I had never seen her cry like that before. She was the type of mom who would tear up sometimes when watching TV, wiping her eyes when a dad told his daughter he loved her in a long-distance phone service commercial, a couple finally reuniting on a sitcom or in a movie, a beloved rapper-turned-actor wishing for his dad to love him like a father should love his son. Those tears were soft, gone within 10 seconds with the help of the top of her t-shirt or cardigan sleeve. These tears scared me, made me wish I had stayed upstairs. Since I didn't know what to say, I took her hand. She dropped the phone and it dangled from its red cord, bounced in midair, and then became a small bundle on the floor. I led her to the attic. Her shoulders were shaking. Some of her hair had fallen out of her ponytail, and it was a dark squiggle on her shoulder. She looked taller and thinner, as if someone had grabbed her head and her feet and pulled them during the brief minutes when I had been upstairs. My mother's feelings were always a sudden downpour to me. I was always soaked with the intensity of them. If she was upset, my teeth were clenching. If she was crying, my eyes were watering. No one else has ever made me feel that way. I could watch a boyfriend gesture furiously at that dumb motherfucker, the driver in the red van who had cut him off, that piece of shit. Listen to a girlfriend ask me why I couldn't just take her side. Why did I have to say, well, they have a point? And didn't I know that a good partner always took their girlfriend's side? Listen to my dad talk over and over about how he was so tired of people gossiping that he had killed Tiana for the insurance money. How angry he was when he heard people saying things like a white man could never truly love a black woman. So of course he had killed her. And I could empathize, nod. But there was always an objectiveness that insulated me, always allowed me to stay cool and diffuse the situation. It was better for everyone if I remained at least 6 inches distant, a space far enough for me to evaluate, assess, and then fix things. But as my mother cried, I cried. I didn't know what was happening. I was sobbing and shaking. In the attic, the lights still on, the deer stood. My mother stopped crying. She said that it was a sign, but did not explain of what. My mother wiped her face with her sleeve. The deer clomped on the ground, huffed. Oh, sweetie, don't be scared. My mom reached for my arm but paused, held her hand out in the air. There was an edge to her voice, an anger. I didn't put that in the essay, but I remember it still. I didn't wipe my face or nose. I let emotions coat my skin. She told me to go downstairs. For a moment, I didn't know why. I was sure she was going to kill the deer. I could see her treating it like a mouse, putting it into a box, dropping a brick on it with her eyes shut. No, I'm fine. I'll stay. Go, Josephine. She rarely called me by my full name. Go. The deer sat. It curled itself into a ball. I took that to mean, it's okay. I'll be fine. In my essay, I wrote that no one could figure out how the deer got into our attic. My mother, the people from animal control who showed up, everyone who was involved in coaxing it safely out of the house, called it the impossible deer. In the 2 months that followed, other impossible things happened to my family. My mother bought a scratch-off lottery ticket and somehow won $70,000. My father was hit by a car straight on and got only a small bruise on his thigh. And I won a statewide essay contest about what Martin Luther King Jr. meant to me. It would cover all my college tuition if I stayed in state for school. I wrote that this all happened because of the deer. Maybe, I suggested throughout the essay, it had been sent by a witch to repay a debt to our family. In her notes, my teacher wrote, "Good, but would be better if you supported this idea with page 79 from the History of Witches. Look at the section about how a witch often brought her blessings by sending an animal familiar. Make it clear in your revisions that witchcraft should be feared." What I did not say.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.